This SciShow video is supported by Linode. You can go to linode.com/scishow to learn more and get a $100 60-day credit on a new Linode account. You are probably familiar with the Large Hadron Collider. You know, that massive ring beneath the France-Switzerland border that smashes teeny tiny particles together at near light speed and hasn't made a black hole that sucked up the Earth like some people feared? Yeah, that Large Hadron Collider, better known as the LHC. Over the past 15 years, the LHC has done a lot of awesome science and made some pretty significant discoveries, so it deserves that name recognition. But there are other particle smashers in the works. They're not all bigger, but they all hope to be better probes of the subatomic. So let's have a look at a few of these upcoming megastructures and what they're going to help us learn about reality as we know it. Our current best understanding of the subatomic world is called the Standard Model, and it can explain the physics of almost everything, from why your coffee cools down after hours at your desk to how radio waves carry your favorite tunes halfway across the world. And it all comes down to a collection of elementary particles, the fundamental building blocks of our reality. That includes particles that make up you and me, like electrons and the quarks inside protons and neutrons, and it includes more exotic bits of matter. But it also includes even weirder particles called bosons. We'll get to the most infamous one of those in just a moment. As tidy as the Standard Model appears to be, there's a lot that it can't explain, which brings us to particle accelerators. They help physicists fill in some of these gaps by taking advantage of the fact that energy can create mass, and vice versa. You know, the good old E equals mc squared. Using super strong magnetic fields, these massive machines ramp up beams of their subatomic specimens to nearly the speed of light and smash them together to watch the energy from those collisions turn into brand new particles. The LHC's most famous accomplishment is probably the detection of the Higgs boson, which was spotted back in 2012. Has it really been that long? Apparently so. But maybe it feels like yesterday because after all this time, there's still a lot we don't know about it. We know the Higgs boson has the very special job of giving other particles in the Standard Model mass. But we still don't know how it does that. So to probe the mysteries of the Higgs boson in more detail, several countries are developing their own version of a Higgs factory. Some, like China's Circular Electron-Positron Collider or CERN's Future Circular Collider, will feature two 100-kilometer rings that accelerate particles in opposite directions. If that sounds big, well, it is. Here's what the FCC will look like next to the LHC. Both of these upcoming colliders build on and improve the existing design of the LHC and use a lot of the same tech. With every trip around the ring, the particles get an energy boost from an electric pulse. And powerful magnets with the strength of 5.5 MRI machines help steer the beams to keep them going around in a circle. Once the particle beams are up to speed, they'll come together at either 2 or 4 collision points, each equipped with its own detector. They'll need to go through a series of upgrades, but eventually, these extra-large colliders will smash particles with over 7 times the energy that the LHC currently achieves. And that extra energy means physicists can study these subatomic particles in even finer detail. But Higgs factories don't have to be ring-shaped. Two other designs, the Japan-hosted International Linear Collider and CERN's Compact Linear Collider, feature a straight line. One upside to using a linear accelerator over a circular one is that you only need the speeding up bits, not the magnetic steering bits, so they can be cheaper to build. But the downside is you only get one go at speeding up the particles, so the boosting tech has to be really good or the collider has to be really long. But whether straight or bendy, all these Higgs factories have the same goals. See, the LHC is kind of messy when it comes to making these elusive Higgs bosons. Because it uses hadrons, which are clusters of quarks, all those collisions end up making a bunch of different particles. And that creates a lot of noise when you're trying to work out what's going on in the specific collisions that create a Higgs boson. So instead of complicated hadrons, Higgs factories will smash electrons with positrons, the electron's positively charged antimatter twin. Unlike quarks, they can exist as solo particles, and when you combine that with the fact that matter and antimatter cancel each other out, it means that collisions between an electron and a positron produce way fewer kinds of particles. So there's a lot less noise for researchers to hunt through when trying to study the Higgs. After finding a way to churn out all these Higgs bosons, physicists will use them to fill in a bunch of gaps in the Standard Model. For example, the fact that the Higgs boson is a mass-giving particle should mean that it's quite heavy, or at least as heavy as the particles it's interacting with. But it's actually light, subatomically speaking. So the Higgs boson may not be the only particle out there that gives other particles mass. It may have a partner in crime that our experiments haven't had enough power or sensitivity to detect yet. And these Higgs factories may be just the advancement that we need. So electrons and positrons are great because they're less complicated than protons. But protons do have one thing going for them. They're heavy. And that heaviness translates into energy. To get the best of both worlds, physicists want to smash a particle called the muon. Muons can basically be thought of as the electron's heavier sibling. In fact, if an electron had the mass of an adult human, then a muon would be an elephant. Not only can muons have a lot more energy in them when collision time comes, their heftiness means they don't lose a lot of energy while they're being swung around their ring. Which means an accelerator doesn't need to work as hard to speed them up compared to their much lighter electron and positron friends. Plus, there's the added benefit that the collider doesn't have to be massive. A muon collider that's 10 kilometers long can achieve similar energies to the LHC, whose particles loop around a 27-kilometer track. And a more compact collider leaves less of an environmental footprint. But muons do have their downside. When muons are made in a lab, they don't tend to bunch together into a nice, tidy beam that you can fire down a pipe. And you need a tight beam so the muons have a high chance of hitting each other when the beams collide. So even though we've known about these particles since the 1930s, and scientists have wanted to build a muon collider since the 1960s, we still don't have one up and running. Progress has been made, though. For example, an experiment called MICE, or the Muon Ionization Cooling Experiment, has managed to reliably fire protons onto a target and then supercool the resulting beam of muons. Like condensing steam back into liquid water, this supercooling corrals the particles into a much narrower beam. But the cooling also slows the muons down, so a bunch of electromagnets need to speed them back up while keeping them bunched up. Repeat this cooling and speeding a couple times, and you've got yourself a muon beam ready for study. Oh, and this all happens before the muons enter the main particle accelerator ring. At the moment, we don't have an operational supercollider dedicated to muon studies, but there is a joint mission between CERN and Fermilab in the US to build one by 2045. When it gets up and running, researchers can use it a bit like a Higgs factory to create and study Higgs boson particles. But the energy they get out of muons could be 20 times greater than the Higgs factories we mentioned before, which could allow them to witness new subatomic particles and interactions. They could even use a muon collider to uncover evidence of dark matter, that mysterious invisible stuff that we're pretty sure is out there and is more abundant than all the matter we can see, but we don't actually know what it is. Now, there's one more particle from the Standard Model that physicists are particularly keen to study, and that's the neutrino. Neutrinos are the neutrally charged cousins to electrons and muons, but are so light that we don't even know what their masses are. In fact, neutrinos are often described as ghosts. They can stream through the entire Earth as if it's not there. And that's not their only superpower. Neutrinos are shapeshifters as well. Imagine buying a milk chocolate bar at the store and coming home to find that it's white chocolate, but then opening the package to see that it's dark. I know. I'd be disappointed as well. Neutrinos and their antimatter twins each come in 3 flavors, and at any given moment can switch or oscillate between those flavors. All of this means that neutrinos are incredibly difficult to detect, let alone study. But incredibly difficult does not mean impossible. There are multiple neutrino detectors around the world that are hard at work picking up the handful of unlucky neutrinos whose ghostly powers failed them at just the wrong moment. But so far, scientists have mostly relied on the sun as their neutrino source, which is a bit annoying. You'd think they'd want more control over exactly how many neutrinos are made and what flavors they are. Well, enter DUNE, the Deep Underground Neutrino Experiment. This massive 1,300-kilometer-long experiment will run all the way from Fermilab in Illinois to the Sanford Underground Research Facility in South Dakota. And DUNE is a bit unusual as far as particle accelerators go. There's no tunnel or ring for the neutrinos to traverse that distance. Neutrinos don't need any of that fancy infrastructure, they'll just fly straight through the Earth. To make its neutrino batches, DUNE's Fermilab accelerator will smack protons into a block of graphite to create new particles. But the most important of those new particles are positively charged pions, which are a type of hadron. These pions are unstable and quickly decay into muons and neutrinos. While the muons get trapped, the neutrinos can just zoom through Fermilab's detector and then off toward the Sanford detector, which is pretty darn massive. When construction finishes, the Sanford detector will have 4 tanks that are each 6 stories stories tall and a football field long. And they'll be filled with 17,000 tons of liquid argon. When a neutrino gets close enough to one of those argon nuclei, it can emit yet another kind of particle in our standard model, either a W or Z boson. Whichever boson pops into existence will quickly crash into a nearby argon, creating a particle shower not entirely unlike what we see in more traditional particle accelerator collisions. And some of those particles will be electrons, which are captured by ultrasensitive instruments on the tank's walls. That's how Dune will indirectly detect neutrinos, but the neutrino's ghostly nature means these events will be pretty rare. Scientists are expecting to pick up around 10 per day once they get started. The detector back at Fermilab will work in a similar way, it's just a lot smaller. So scientists will be able to compare the results coming from both to investigate the neutrino's shape-shifting powers. They might even figure out why there's so much matter in the universe. According to the standard model, the energy of our universe's birth should have created an equal number of matter and antimatter particles. A perfect balance that would make some supervillains weep with joy. But reality seems to be out of balance, favoring matter. Unless there's some section of the universe that we can't find that has entire antimatter galaxies filled with antimatter stars and planets, and maybe an antimatter you. So scientists hope to see whether or not matter neutrinos and antimatter neutrinos oscillate according to the same rules. If they don't, well, maybe one consequence is our universe's preference for matter. As for how long we might have to wait to get those answers, well, a prototype Dune has already been tested out, and the whole experiment plans to be online by the mid-2030s, which, given the scale of a megaproject such as this, is right around the corner. So it's a very exciting time ahead for the field of physics. By building these spectacular machines to study Higgs bosons, muons, and neutrinos, there's the possibility we'll have a totally new understanding of our universe within our lifetimes. It takes a ton of investment to build these accelerators that probe the parts of our world that are too small to see, but if it reveals the fundamental nature of reality, well, I say it's worth it. And when you focus on the little things, the big picture sometimes becomes much clearer. And when it comes to the little things, Linode has thought of them all. It can be difficult to learn how to use a new tool or platform, so Linode, the cloud computing company from Akamai, has done everything they can to walk you through the many uses of their cloud computing technology and how to implement them yourself. They post tutorials and guides for their open source resources all over their website and YouTube channel. And to provide you with as many ways of learning as possible, including personalized guidance, they offer award-winning customer support at your service 365 days of the year. With Linode, you're not paying for some mysterious cloud computing service. They incorporate many open source tools, and they're there to show you how to use them. To get started, you can click the link in the description or head to linode.com/scishow. That link will give you a $100 60-day credit on a new Linode account. Thanks to Linode for supporting this SciShow video.